we sing, today is graduation Sunday for many, and in lieu of that, as we think about that, as people are transitioning from those teenage years into college or on into workplace, one of the things that is a challenge is to continue to follow Christ. And this morning we're going to sing a song. You might know it, you might not. Do your best. It's called I Will Follow.
Bible I was looking for you. As we give our graduates a Bible every year,
And that is a new life application study Bible. And so we have that ordered. We got that ready for you to come. And so it will be coming. The check's in the mail, really. So, but we have a card for you. And we want to say congratulations on your hard work. And I want to know where I can get one of these. That's what they need. Kohl's. Okay, great. Good deal. So thank you. I mentioned this morning in our prayer time beforehand that this is Roy and Pam's last to graduate, and so it's a change for them. And I know that today is graduation Sunday, so reality is some of you need to sneak out of here early. We understand that, so on cue, you all can, when you need to just go, and we'll try not to stare at you and make you feel uncomfortable and such. Maybe Bob will, but that's okay. So we just want to thank you all for being here for the time that you can be here. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward to receive the morning tithes and offerings. This is an opportunity for us as a body of Christ to give back to God. This is an act of worship as we give back to Him because it's all His anyhow. He blesses us. So as we give to Him, this is saying, thank you, Lord, and I'm trusting you for everything that I need. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. God, you are so good to us. You watch over us every step of the way. You pray for us, Lord, interceding. The Bible says that you, Jesus, intercede on our behalf. That's talking to the Father. You care for us, Lord, and we just thank you and praise you for that. Lord, as we give out of gratitude, Lord, I pray that we wouldn't give grudgingly, but we would give out of gratitude, out of a thankful heart, a cheerful giver. And we praise you, and we just bless your name. Amen. stand here and sing songs and just not even be thinking, just kind of going through it, going through the motions, whether it's just something you do, or you enjoyed it, or you're listening to someone next to you sing because they got such a pretty voice, and we kind of check out. And our challenge is to stay connected in what we're doing, and when we sing and we lift up the words and the song, it really is an offering of worship and praise to Him, whether we're singing a really fast contemporary song, or a reflective, deep theological hymn, or a song like this one that really is drawing us back to who we are, to who God is.
God, you've called us to bring light into a dark and hopeless world. And that comes from you and you alone. And all these things, Lord, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
We do not have children's church. I actually turned it off. Sorry about that. This week we do not actually have. We do not have children's church. We apologize for that. Again, I said if you have to get up and leave for the graduation stuff, that is totally fine. And if you'll take your Bibles and turn to Acts chapter 10. When I look at a patch of dandelions, I see a bunch of weeds that are going to make my, or that are going to take over my yard. But kids see flowers for mom and blowing the white stuff, the white fluff that you can wish on. When I look at an old drunk and he smiles at me, I see a smelly, dirty person who probably wants money and I look away. Kids see someone smiling at them, and they start laughing. When I hear music I love, I know I can't carry a tone or a tune, and I don't have much rhythm, so I sit self-consciously and listen. Kids feel the beat, and they move to it. They sing out the words, and if they don't know them, they make up their own. When I feel the wind on my face, I brace myself against it. I feel it messing up my hair and pulling me back when I walk. Kids close their eyes, spread their arms, and fly with it until they fall to the ground laughing. When I pray, I say thee and thou, and grant me this, and grant me this. Kids say, hi God, thanks for my toys and my friends. Please keep the bad dreams away tonight, and sorry, I don't want to go to heaven yet. I wouldn't miss mommy and daddy. When I see a mud puddle, I step around it. I see muddy shoes and clothes and dirty carpets. Kids sit in it. They see dams to build and rivers to cross and worms to play with. I wonder if we are given kids to teach or to learn from. No wonder God loves little children. Isn't that true? They have a completely different outlook on life. They want to continue to gain all the things that they can, but we've got a schedule to keep. They want to play, we've got to go places. Such a different perspective. There's three things that we'll look at today, and you can explain those in three ways. Number one, God is inviting, so we're getting an invitation. Number two, God is challenging, so we're going to get a challenge. And number three, God is preparing, and so we're going to have that explained also. James chapter 4, verses 6 through 8, let me just read this to begin with. Number one, God is inviting us, what? To a personal relationship, to a personal walk with Him. James 4, 6 through 8 says, but he gives us more grace. That is why scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. If we look at that scripture from James, and we look at that and say, how do I walk with the Lord? What is that invitation to walk with Him? We can look at that. It gives us kind of a roadmap of how to do this. So, starts out, number one, God's going to give us grace. More grace. He opposes the proud. but shows favor to the humble. So if we're looking at a way to walk with him, we need to get an idea. We need to look and understand that I need to be humble first, because he does what to the proud? Opposes the proud. But he gives grace, or he shows favor to the humble. And then submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. So we need to start out by being humble. We need to submit to God. We've talked about the whole submission thing. It's much like a knight submitting to his king. Submit to God. Resist the devil. Okay? And he will flee from you. Well, if I'm submitting to my king, I'm certainly not going to submit to another king. In fact, what the knight would do if another king came to oppose his king, he would draw his sword. He'd ready himself for battle. So it says, God opposes the proud. He gives grace, or he shows favor to the humble. We're supposed to submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Do you see some things here? These are action items for us to do. These are things that we need to do. A lot of times in our walk with Christ, we think we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we're all good. That's all we got to do. Got a little fire insurance, a little God on our side, kind of like a little salt and pepper sprinkled on our mashed potatoes for flavor. But what God is calling us to is a walk with him, this intense walk with him. And he says here, and James gives us how to do this. And they're action items, things that we need to do. It just doesn't happen. It just doesn't happen. You know, if you ran out there in that bare empty field and farmer worked up and we just threw the seed out there, just threw it out there, didn't do anything, we didn't work the soil up, we didn't do anything to get the seed in the ground, we didn't do anything to help it grow, we just threw it out there. Just hope that I'll do okay. And we can't do that with our lives or walk with Christ. We can't just say, okay, God, I accepted you, I'm all good now. We need to do things to cultivate our walk with Christ. So we need to kind of have this understanding to begin with before we get into Acts here. So it says, come near to God and he'll come near to you. Wash your hands. My hands are what I do things with, right? So this represents our actions. Wash your hands. Can I say it this way? Clean up your actions. Clean up the things that you're doing on the outside. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your heart. Your heart's on the inside. So it's not just what you do on the outside, but it's what's happening on the inside also. So I'm washing my hands, I'm purifying my heart. These are things I'm doing. And I do that through the power of the Holy Spirit. So this is just kind of a little lesson here before we get going. Because what we're going to hit on today is so important. Acts chapter 10, verses 1 through 8 is where we're going to begin. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion, in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly. One day, about 3 in the afternoon, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel of God come to him and said, Cornelius. Cornelius stared at him in fear. What is it, Lord? He asked. The angel answered, your prayers and your gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the Tanner, whose house is by the sea. When the angel who spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called 2 of his servants and a devout soldier who was one of his attendants. He told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa. So here we have a Roman centurion. This is a man who was not just some soldier, but he was actually over, and he was part of the Italian regiment. He's known as a God-fearer, someone who respected
God Almighty, the God of the Jews. He had not converted to Judaism, but he was a God-fearer. Cornelius was known for his generosity to the poor. He was also a man of prayer. It's good to note all these different things that we read about Cornelius so that we understand that all these good things that Cornelius is not enough for what God is calling us to. It's good. And those are things that we should do, but that kind of stuff is not getting us into heaven. And it's not that walk with Christ. But God is calling us to that walk. God sent this angel to Cornelius because God did recognize Cornelius' honest attempt to draw near to God. God made it clear to him that he had a message for him and that he was to come through Peter. You know, there are several ways in which some of us may relate to Cornelius. Maybe we're a God-fearer. I really respect God. I trust God to a certain extent. I know that he's out there. I know that there's a God. I'm a good person, basically. We can relate to him. Maybe we even pray to him like Cornelius. We're generous like him. We help others. Maybe we're even a person of influence, and we use that influence for godly things. You see, Cornelius was looking for acceptance from God through good deeds. If you've ever known someone who is an extreme people pleaser, someone who wants to constantly keep the peace with everybody and will go to great lengths to please, Cornelius was trying to please God through all that he was doing. Many today are also looking for acceptance through good deeds, through religion. They do certain things because they know it's the right thing to do. And it becomes religious. Revelation 3:20 says, "Look, here I stand at the door and knock. If you hear me calling and open the door, I will come in and we will share a meal as friends." You see, if we sincerely seek after God, we will find him. God's calling us not to simply come and seek after him, but he's calling us to join him. To join him in what he's doing. As it says in Revelation there, "I will come and we will share a meal as friends." Cornelius was open to the Lord's calling and he sent for Peter. Why do we struggle with a relationship with God? Why do we struggle understanding what it takes? We're so used to earning everything. When we go through school, from little on up, we try hard to earn good grades. We try hard to get attention. We try hard to get awards. When we get out and we get into college, we look to get somehow earn a place in a company, a place, some place where we'll be recognized, where we'll earn more, more, more. We're conditioned this way. And it comes from within. And so our relationship with Christ many times is us trying to earn God's favor by doing certain things, by acting a certain way, by dressing a certain way, by coming to church all the time. We can't get into that mode of just trying to please God. Instead of understanding that our walk with God, out of that walk with Christ, springs everything else that we do. That we don't attend church to get merit points or brownie badges from God. We come together at church because it's good for us. And it's good for others. You know, some of you joke, I say, "Good morning, glad to see you." And you know, I've heard several of you, "It's glad to be seen. I'm glad to be seen. Glad you can see me." Well, you know what? That's true. That's true. I need you. And you need me. Together, we're the body of Christ. And church should be a place where we come together and are encouraged. We shouldn't walk out the doors more depressed than we walked in. We come together to be encouraged and lifted up. Many times you all walk out that door and don't remember my message, but the message God brought to you through the other people in this church sticks with you. And that's okay. We're the body of Christ, and God uses us to minister to each other. I'd really like it if you didn't remember, but I understand that doesn't always happen. I've been on that side of things. So God is challenging us out of our comfort zone too. So he calls us, and then he challenges us out of that comfort zone. Let's look at verses 9 through 16 in chapter 10. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. But while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven open and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. It contains all kinds of four-footed animals as well as reptiles of the earth and birds of the air. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." "Surely not, Lord," Peter replied. "I have never eaten anything impure or unclean." The voice spoke to him a second time, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened three times, and immediately the sheep was taken back up to heaven. While Peter was wondering about the meaning of this vision, the men sent for Cornelius around and found out where Simon's house was and stopped at the gate. They called out, asking if Simon, who was known as Peter, was staying there. I went a little over there. So the houses of Palestine, you have to understand, Peter went up on the roof. The houses in Palestine were flat. The roofs were flat there. And so many times they would have an extra room up there, or they would have a place that they could go. And if you can imagine, for us, when we build our houses, we like to build decks on our houses. And that's where we would lounge around outside. We might put up a gazebo, we might have a tent, we might have something like that. In Palestine, that was on the roof of their house. And so Peter's up there on the roof of his house, and he's praying when he falls into a trance. Let me make that a little clearer for you if you don't, what's that? Well, Peter had a vision. He had a vision, and in that vision, God shows him all these animals that he would consider unclean to eat. Like the Jews, they wouldn't eat a pig. A Jew would not eat a reptile. When you say reptile, yeah, sure. Haven't you gone down south and had alligator? Or have you ever had a turtle? Yeah, some of you are out there going, no, thank you. Well, to all these things that they were off limits, shellfish and certain seafood and stuff, they couldn't eat. If you like going to Red Lobster, don't become Jewish. These are things that Peter could not eat. But God said, look, this is all stuff that I have now declared clean. And Peter's struggling. He's struggling. Lord, I've never eaten this stuff. And God says, look, if I declare it clean, don't you call it unclean. So Peter's got all this stuff going on in his head. His vision, his trance, this is heavy stuff for him. And then Cornelius' guys show up. So this is all, this is whirlwind. God's up to something here. Something huge. This is a turning point in the book of Acts. It's a turning point for us as a church, as we see God open up the door for the ministry of the Gentiles and basically saying, you know what? Come on in and be a part of the family of God. Come on in and be a part of my chosen people. What does that mean, chosen people? For those who will trust in him and follow him, you are God's chosen people. You are the ones. If you will trust him, you become his family.
We sing that song occasionally here. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. We're a family. We are a family. So God uses Peter's state of hunger to speak to him, his spiritual state. He reveals his prejudices towards the Gentiles. Do you know that Peter struggles with this a good portion of his life? He struggles with this prejudice against the Gentiles. He grew up with this thought pattern. It wasn't just a matter of a religious separation, but it was a cultural separation. It was a racial separation. It was a struggle for Peter, and God is confronting this. He's also then directed to go with men who were coming from Cornelius' house. You may not think much about that, but what kind of person is Cornelius? Is he a Jew or a Gentile? Cornelius is a Gentile. He's a Roman soldier. And did you know that a Jew could not go into the house of a Gentile? So here's God. I almost can say this is, God is messing with Peter's mind here. Peter, I'm going to use you. You were a coward. You denied me 3 times. I'm going to fill you full of my spirit. I'm going to invite you back. And I'm going to make you a powerful preacher. He sets Peter on fire. He preaches that powerful sermon on the day of Pentecost. And 3,000 people come to Christ that same day. He takes the coward and he makes him a courageous preacher. He takes this man who was a fisherman. He takes this Jew who did not want to do anything outside that. He says, Peter, I'm going to send you and I'm going to have you preach. I'm going to use you, and I'm going to teach you how to be my mouthpiece to the world. Has God ever messed with your mind? God, you want me to do that? I'm pretty sure I must not be hearing right. You want what? You're going to send me? Jessica, what happens when God says, go to Spain? If he just said that your freshman year of college, wow. She's taken off on an internship to Spain. We're thrilled. Denny, when you were driving a truck, could you have imagined nearly 30 years served abroad, preaching the gospel. God, you want me? Bob, when God said, I want you, and you responded, I'll do whatever you want. How many sermons have you preached now? How many messages have you? When God says, I want you to walk away from that old life, I'm going to call you out of where you feel comfortable. I want to call you out of that because I have something for you. Larry, when God speaks to you and says, Larry, I want you to have a business, and I want you to have a business that is God-centered and ethical and cares about the family. It's awesome. 20 years ago, could you imagine? God takes us through these things. And he calls us. And sometimes it messes with our thinking. It messes with what we're comfortable with. But he calls us, and that's what God does here. God spoke to Peter, and when Peter was still before him, it came clear. Maybe we need to just take some time to be quiet and let God speak to us clearly. Because our days are so busy, we've got stuff from the beginning to the end. We've got this appointment, that appointment. We're running through fast food. We're eating in the go. We don't have time to simply sit down and be quiet. want to question all of our traditions. You may want to ask us to do something different. Maybe they're hindering what he has. Finally, God is preparing us to reach others with the good news. Let's finish up this section 17 through verse 33, chapter 7, or verse 17 through verse 33. We'll start at 19, actually. Verse 19, while Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, Simon, three men are looking for you. So get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them. Peter went down and said to the men, I am the one you're looking for. Why have you come? The men replied, we have come from Cornelius, the centurion. He's a righteous and God-fearing man who is respected by all the Jewish people. A holy angel told him to have you come to his house so that he could hear what you have to say. Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guest. Again, here's Gentiles going into a Jew's house now. This is all stuff that just wasn't acceptable. The next day, Peter started out with them and some of the brothers from Joppa went along. The following day, they arrived at Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them, and he had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. But Peter made him get up. Stand up, he said. I'm only a man myself. Talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. He said to them, you are all well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without raising any objections. May I ask why you have sent for me? Verse 30. Cornelius answered, 4 days ago, I was in my house praying at this hour, at 3 p.m. Suddenly a man in shining clothes stood before me and said, Cornelius, God has heard your prayer and remembered your gifts to the poor. Send to Joppa for Simon, who is called Peter. He is a guest at the home of Simon the Tanner, who lives by the sea. So I sent for you immediately, and it was good for you to come. Now we all are here in the presence of God to listen to everything the Lord has commanded you to tell us. You see, God is preparing us for something specific. He prepared Peter for something. He gave Peter the instruction to go. He made him comfortable with what was going on, at least a little bit comfortable. And then on top of that, he had Cornelius, spoke to Cornelius. And so he brought these together so that he could speak. Peter agrees to go to Caesarea with the men. It takes them almost a day and a half to reach there. And then on top of it, Cornelius gathers all his family together. So when Peter and the people in Cornelius sent, and it said that some of the brothers from Joppa went, they all get there. It's the stage being set up for God as he reaches into the Gentile world. We'll finish this whole account next week. But as we come to a close today, sometimes God calls us to do things we don't understand. God, why me? Why would you want me to do that? Why am I going through this? Why am I struggling here? We have our idea of how things should be or what we will do, but God has no problem challenging our thoughts on these things. He's called us to reach a world and to a people, to reach out to a people with a personal relationship with him. So why do we struggle when God asks us to do things? Sometimes we have the fear of what others might think. When God calls us, sometimes we look at it and say, God, the logistics of this thing is just crazy. How am I going to do this? I would have to do this. I'd have to do this. I can't do this. When God speaks to us, maybe we bargain with God. God, I just couldn't talk in front of somebody. I could never share something like that. God, I get so nervous. I'm so worried about this. I'm so worried about that. But God will provide. He gives us that assurance that he will.
He wants us to trust him. And so today, as we come to a close, God's challenge, God's calling on us goes on every day. Maybe you've had that challenge. Maybe you've wondered, God, why? What difference would it make? Why are you asking me to do that? Why are you calling me? Why are you talking to me to have a deeper walk with you? Why do I need to read the Bible every day? Why do I need to spend time in prayer? God, do you really want me to go pray with that person? Lord, you want me to spend time with them, but Lord, they're annoying. We have all kinds of excuses. I talk about our closet full of excuses. There's tons of them. I've got my closet full, you've got your closet full. Peter had his closet full of excuses. We're going to see what happens next week when Peter empties his closet and does what God says. He's there. He's in the household now. He's standing before an entire family of Gentiles. And I wonder how many of that Italian regiment were standing there in that room with him. Because Peter was willing to walk away from the excuses. Maybe if you walk out of here today with one thing that you can put in your pocket and take away from here, maybe that would be, God, what excuses are holding me back from doing what I know I should do? If you can take that little thought and put it in your hand, let's do that. Everybody take out your hand like this, right? Because we're going to take something away, because otherwise, what's the point of all this, right? Let's take something. Take your hand out there. What you're going to put in your hand today is the question. What excuses am I making that are holding me back from what God's asking me to do? Close your hand. Put it in your pocket. Remember this week as you walk out of here. Maybe today when you reach in for your billfold, when you're out to eat, or you're over somebody's house, or you're getting home, you pull your keys out. Pull a question out. What excuses are holding you back from doing what God's asking you to do? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we have a lesson learned here from Peter, a fisherman, a devout Jewish man who did not want to associate with the Gentiles. It wasn't just that, Lord, but they despised the Romans. And Lord, you addressed Peter's excuses. You addressed the whole eating thing. You addressed the fact that Cornelius was a Gentile. You addressed his excuses. And Lord, Peter was open. We look to begin with that at James, where we're supposed to resist the devil. We're supposed to be humble. We're supposed to submit to you. And so, Lord, we submit to you. Speak to us about our excuses. And then, Lord, speak to us about what you want us to do. We pray these things today in your name. I want to thank you for being here today, and I know that probably some of you have graduations to go to or family get-togethers of a sort. I just want to thank you for being a part
of young men and young women's lives as they grow up. It's fun to watch them change into men and women and to see how God uses them. Lord, is this. Thank you.